السلام عليكم، اهلا وسهلا بيكم. كل سنه وحضراتكم طيبين، واهلا وسهلا بيكم في ويبينار جديد وويبينار مهم وموضوع يهم سبيشالتيز كتيره جدا، سواء كانوا بقى بيدياتريك، كلينيكال نيوتريشن، فاميلي ميديسن او جنرال براكتيشنر. اهلا وسهلا بيكم، ويا رب الويبينار او موضوع جديد يعجبكم ان شاء الله. انا هرقب نفسي برضه سريعا، انا دكتور رامي الشربيني، كول سنتر اوف بيدياتريك نيماتولوجي بيدياتريك كلينيكال نيوتريشن. النهارده ان شاء الله هنتكلم عن موضوع جديد اسمه ريفيدنج سيندروم. طيب طبعا ده الاوت لاين بتاعنا بتاع المحاضره والاجنده، ان شاء الله كومبينيشن اوف ريفيدنج سيندروم، هيستوري اوف ريفيدنج سيندروم، باسيت سيلز اوف ريفيدنج سيندروم، انسيدنس اوف ريفيدنج سيندروم، سيمبتومز اند بريفنشن اند تريتمنت اوف ريفيدنج سيندروم. طيب خلينا نتكلم الاول وات از ريفيدنج سيندروم. Refeeding syndrome is a set of metabolic and electrolyte alterations occurring due to reintroduction of calories either through oral, enteral, parenteral nutrition after a period of consistent reduction of energy intake or starvation in individuals with pre-existent malnutrition or catabolic state. The keyword for definition: reintroduction of calories after a period of consistent reduction of energy or starvation. طيب ايه اللي هو الهيستو ريفيدنج سيندروم او وين ات فيرست ديفايند اند ديسكرايبد. ذا هيستو ريفيدنج سيندروم شوز ذات ات واز فيرست ديسكرايبد ان ذا فار ايست بريزنر افتر وور افتر سكند وورلد وور وي ار ستارتنج تو ايت اجين افتر ا بيريد اوف برونز سارفيجن سيمز تو بريسبيت كاردياك فيلير. وانا اربع كده موست كومن كوز اوف ديث فروم ريفيدنج سيندروم هو الكاردياك اريزميز. طيب خلينا نتكلم عن definition in more detail. During Second World War, many people suffered from hunger and starvation. Under these circumstances, an American physiologist called Ansel Keys investigated the physical and mental effect of prolonged dietary restriction and subsequent refeeding of 36 prisoners. Most of the subjects, we noticed that most of the subjects experienced severe emotional distress, social withdrawal, isolation, decline in concentration and decrease in metabolic rate, respiration and heart rate. Also, many of them showed edema in their extremities. Later on, at the end of the Second World War, a further observation was made by scientists and showed that they experienced severe symptoms, including heart failure, peripheral edema, neurological disorder after a normal diet was reintroduced. And also one of five died within the next few days. This observation led to the first description of refeeding syndrome about 26 years old. طيب خلينا نتكلم عن الباثوفيسيولوجي اوف ريفيدنج سيندروم. الباثوفيسيولوجي اوف ريفيدنج سيندروم includes or is related to shifts from catabolic to anabolic pathways occurring after restart of feeding in undernourished subjects. يبقى الكيورد في الباثوفيسيولوجي اوف ريفيدنج سيندروم هي شيفت فروم ان كاتابوليك تو انابوليك ميتابوليك باث واي افتر ستارت اوف فيدنج ان اندر نارشد سبجكت. طيب خلينا بقى نتكلم عن الباثوفيسيولوجي ان مور ديتيلز. ان كاتابوليك ستيت دو تو ريديوس ذا فود انتيك اور ايفن ستارفيشن انسولين برودكشن از ديكريز ديو تو هايبوغلايسيميا اند جلوكاكون اند كاتيكولامين اند سلايتلي ستيمولييتد. During fasting, glucose oxidation is reduced and only takes place in the glucose-dependent tissues, including the brain, renal medulla, and red blood cells. The glycogen stores are reduced, which lead to activation of gluconeogenesis and the production of endogenous amino acids, which is released by increased proteolysis, which lead to reduction in muscle mass, functional weakness, and weight loss. Also, vitamins and electrolytes are decreased and stores are depleted. After a few days, lipolysis increases, leading to the raised level of free fatty acid, which leads to stimulation of ketogenesis in the liver due to high production of ketone bodies, which became the main suppliers of energy for the body. During catabolic state, metabolic processes are reduced to 30, from 30 to 50% of normal, and the body now is surviving slowly by slowly consuming itself. طيب احنا قلنا في الاول احنا قلنا في الديفينيشن وقلنا في الباث فيسيولوجي ان هو اذا شيفت فروم كاتابوليك تو انابوليك ستيت. طيب احنا اتكلمنا عن الكاتابوليك ستيت، نتكلم بقى عن الانابوليك ستيت. If balanced nutrition support is with carbohydrate is introduced, or what's called refeeding, glucose becomes the main source of energy, which lead to hyperglycemia and to increase insulin secretion and to lead to sudden shift from fat to carbohydrate metabolism. Insulin stimulates the sodium potassium ATP-based supporter, which need magnesium as cofactor, which lead to transport of glucose and potassium into the cell and transport of sodium out of the cell. Insulin releases to meet the metabolic process, which requires minerals, mainly phosphorus, potassium, and magnesium, and the coenzyme, which is called thiamine. المشاكل كلها تبدأ تحصل after stimulation of insulin secretion due to hyperglycemia. Electrolyte shift lead to profound hypophosphatemia and low extracellular magnesium and potassium, but not necessarily the depletion of all together. The refeeding syndrome مش لازم طبعا يبقى feed depletion of phosphorus, magnesium and potassium, ممكن phosphorus فقط أو ممكن كلهم. وحتى يعني هنعرف بعد كده ان refeeding syndrome can be defined when there is only hypophosphatemia, because hypophosphatemia is the hallmark of refeeding syndrome. Insulin also has an antinatriuretic effect in renal tubules, which decrease in urinary sodium and water excretion, lead to fluid overload, which lead to congestive heart failure, arrhythmia, and pulmonary edema. This is a diagram explaining it's a brief diagram about the pathophysiology of refeeding syndrome. طبعا احنا قلنا وبرضه الفينيكس سيندروم بيحصل برضه في البيشنت اللي هم عندهم كوفيد 19 افتر اللي هم ادمتد افتر سيفير ستارفيشن برضه او مال نيوتريشن. طبعا هنتكلم عن الدايجرام ويتش سمرايزنج ذا باثوفيسيولوجي اوف الفينيكس سيندروم. برضه احنا قلنا ان الفينيكس سيندروم اذا شيفت فروم كاتابوليك تو انابوليك فيز. هنتكلم عن الكاتابوليزم اور مانيوتريشن. زي ما قلنا ديكريز انسولين سيكريشن انكريز جلوكاجون سيكريشن ويتش ليد تو جلايكوجينولايسيس بروتين كاتابوليزم اند ديكريز جلوكونيوجينيسيس فيتامين اند مينرال نيوترين ديكريزز اور ديبليتد. نتكلم بقى احنا قلنا برضه ان هو شيفت فروم كاتابوليك تو انابوليك. نتكلم عن انابوليك وين ذير از ريفيدنج كاربوهيدرات بيكيم ذا مين سورس اوف انرجي ويتش ستيمليت انسولين سيكريشن ويتش ليد انكريز تو بروتين سنسز and decrease excretion of sodium and water, leading to sodium retention and decrease extracellular fluid volume, and also increase glucose uptake, thiamine use, and intracellular shift of phosphorus, magnesium, and potassium, which lead to hypomagnesemia, hypophosphatemia, and hypokalemia, and thiamine deficiency, and sodium and water retention. وطبعا leads many complications. هنعرفها later on the symptoms. طيب خلينا بقى نتكلم عن incidence of refeeding syndrome. Of course, the incidence of refeeding syndrome is underestimated due to many reasons. First, insufficient monitoring of electrolytes after nutrition starting. ونعرف في المونيتور في المانجمنت اوف refeeding syndrome ان من اهم الستبس هي المونيتورنج. You have to, after refeeding and after starting nutrition support, you have to monitor your patient's electrolytes for fear of any electrolyte disturbance which can lead to more complications. Also, lack of consultation, non-specificity of the clinical manifestation, well, physician awareness, physician unawareness, which is very important, that there must be a nutritional team working together in a teamwork for proper prognosis of refeeding syndrome. Also, physicians should consider malnutrition is an additional disease of any patient. When you handle any patient, you have to take care of the general condition of the patient, and also you have to assess the nutritional state of your patient. Indeed, either hypophosphatemia only or multiple electrolyte abnormalities with or without clinical manifestation have been considered in its definition. طبعا احنا قلنا قبل كده ان الفينيكس سيندروم مش لازم يبقى كل الالكترولايت ديفيشنت. ممكن يبقى الفوسفورس بس هو اللي ديفيشنت, وممكن يجي ويز اور وداوت كلينيكال مانيفستيشن زي ما احنا هنشوف بعد كده. The reported incidence ranged from 0 to 80% depending on the definition and the patient population studied. Refeeding syndrome has been described in 48% of severely malnourished patients, 34% of ICU patients, 33% of anorexia nervosa, 25% of carcinoid patients. So 9.5% of patients hospitalized from malnutrition from GIT fistula. امبالنت نيوتريشن مينز 100% انسنس اوف هايبوفوسفاتيميا. طبعا احنا عارفين في during preparation of parenteral nutrition calcium or phosphorus should be introduced with a specific ratio to prevent precipitation of calcium and phosphorus, and in many and also calcium and phosphorus will be prepared outside of the bag of parenteral nutrition, which can lead to hypophosphatemia. Of course, the expert nutrition pharmacist must be aware from this condition and supplement phosphorus also guided by the monitoring of the electrolyte fortification. Severe hypophosphatemia had led to mortality of 18.2% compared to 4.6% mortality without hypophosphatemia. As we mentioned before, hypophosphatemia is the main or the hallmark of refeeding syndrome. طيب خلينا نتكلم عن symptoms of refeeding syndrome. A syndrome of refeeding syndrome generally appears within 2 to 5 days of refeeding. Symptoms range from absent to mild to severe to life-threatening. As we mentioned before, in the refeeding syndrome is accompanied by either hypophosphatemia or hypophosphatemia, hypomagnesemia, hypokalemia, with or without clinical manifestation. Absent clinical manifestation, which can be also mild or severe or life-threatening, depending on the pre-existing degree of malnutrition and comorbidity. All body organs may be involved, زي ما هنشوف بعد كده في الـ symptoms. Abnormal glucose and lipid metabolism, suppresses gluconeogenesis, reduced amino acid usage, less negative nitrogen balance, hyperglycemia, lipogenesis, hypertriglyceridemia, fatty liver and abnormal liver function test. لو انتوا خدتوا بالكم ان في لايبوجينيسيس في هايبرترايجلسيديميا في فاتي ليفر ابنورمال ليفر فانكشن تيست which في ستاديز كتيره جدا قالت ان الريفيدنج سيندروم اند ميتابوليك سيندروم ار تو سايدز اوف ذا سيم كوين تو سايدز اوف ذا سيم كوين they have many things in they have they are different but they have but they have something in common which are hypomagnesemia and hypokalemia and hypophosphatemia لان هم مهمين جدا في الميتابوليزم اوف جلوكوز وكمان الهايبوفوسفاتيميا كان ليد تو انسولين ريزيستنت which one of the components of metabolic syndrome also fatty liver is one of the components of metabolic syndrome and hypertriglyceridemia some studies mentioned that in metabolic syndrome and the feeding syndrome are two sides of the same coin. What about thiamine deficiency? It can lead to vernix encephalopathy, or what's called Korsakoff syndrome, which is manifested by ocular disturbance, confusion, ataxia, loss of ability to coordinate muscular movement, coma, short-term memory loss, confabulation, confusion of imagination with memory. Also, hyperphosphatemia leads to impaired cellular energy pathway, impaired skeletal muscle function, weakness and myopathy, seizures, impaired blood clotting processes, and hemolysis also can occur. What about hypomagnesemia? Hypomagnesemia, most cases are not clinically significant, but in severe cases, there's cardiac arrhythmia, which is the most common cause of death from Phoenix syndrome is cardiac arrhythmia. Also, abdominal discomfort, anorexia, tremors, seizures, confusion, and weakness. Hypokalemia, also cardiac arrhythmia, hypotension, weakness, paralysis, respiratory depression, cardiac arrest. Remember, even an overweight or obese patient can be malnourished and can be a victim of refeeding syndrome. Also remember, we said that almost or many organs of the body are involved or are involved in metabolic syndrome or affected of metabolic syndrome, as we said, bleeding disorder, confusion, seizures, abdominal discomfort, confabulation, many organs in the cardiac arrhythmia, many organs are affected by refeeding syndrome. What about prevention of refeeding syndrome? The key word in prevention of refeeding syndrome is identification of patients at risk for refeeding syndrome, which is considered the first step to prevent the onset of the syndrome. First step in prevention is identification of patients at risk and to avoid an excessive nutritional replenishment in those individuals. Risk factors should be carefully investigated before starting either refeeding, which is either oral, enteral, parenteral, because every route of calorie administration is implicated in the occurrence of refeeding syndrome. Type refeeding syndrome is likely to occur within the first 3 hours 3 days, sorry, 72 hours after the start of nutrition therapy and progress rapidly. So quick recognition is critical and requires well-trained medical staff and specialized nutritional support team, which include physicians, nurses, pharmacists, which has a positive impact on the patient's outcome and the prognosis of the disease. طبعا ده diagram shows the nutritional team, includes the physician, which is considered the leader of the team, responsible for diagnosis management overall plan, also the nurse, which is responsible for screening, enteral nutrition, parenteral nutrition, and monitoring, also the pharmacist, which is responsible for parenteral nutrition monitoring and nutrition care, also the dietitian, which is responsible for enteral nutrition monitoring, screening, assessment, nutrition care plan, and monitoring of the patient. Type. Screening of Refeeding syndrome, which is the most important point of prevention, as we mentioned before, should be performed within the first 24 to 48 hours through validated screening tools, which include nutritional risk screening 2002, mini nutritional assessment short form, also malnutrition universal screening tool or MAST tool, the short nutritional assessment questionnaire. If an individual is identified to be at risk of malnutrition, so then the second step, which is extensive nutritional assessment for diagnosis and evaluation of severity of malnutrition, which should be carried, as we said before, by an expert in nutrition or to be specified by an expert team, which includes the physician, the pharmacist, the dietitian, and the nurse. Type. هناخد overview سريع عن الـ validated nutritional screening tools. Nutrition screening NRS 2002 دي points معينة انت بتديها score وفي الآخر بتجمع السكور وفي الآخر بناء على هذا السكور بتحدد هل هو at risk or not at risk. يعني هنا بيتكلم عن nutrition status هل هو عنده هنان يعني عنده ما عندوش مشكلة mild malnutrition moderate malnutrition, severe malnutrition according to the weight loss and nutrition intake in the last week برضو في severity of the disease or what is called stress metabolism هل نان هل mild هل moderate هل severe وطبعا وكل واحدة فيهم بيبقى ليها score وطبعا الadvanced age هل هو أكتر يعني هل هو أكتر من 70 أو أقل من 70 يعني أكتر أو 70 أو أكتر أو أقل من 70 وطبعا بتجمع السكورينج دوت اللي هو خد من 0 2 بوينتس يبقى ده جاست ريبيت سكريننج ويكلي لو هو من 3 تو 7 بوينت لا البيشنت ده از ات نيوتريشنال ريسك اند نيدز نيوتريشن كير بلان فور بريفنشن اوف كومبليكيشن. طيب برضه في الانترناشنال انيشيتيف سكور شورت فورم شورت فورم ده برضه سكور ده برضه سكرين تول تاني طبعا ده في من الاولد فيرجن والنيو فيرجن في طبعا الماست تول ويمكن ده يعني اكثر حاجه بيستخدمها الكلينيشن ده عباره عن ستيبس وسيف 1 و 2 و 3 و 4 انت بتجمع السكورز اللي عملتها وبناء عليه بتحدد هل هو لو ريسك ميديوم ريسك ولا هاي ريسك. سيف 1 انت بتتكلم عن بي ام اي هل هو اكثر من 20 او ده بتدي له 0 هل هو من 18 ونص ل 20 بتدي له 1 اقل من 18 ونص بتدي له 2 weight loss score اللي هو unintentioned weight loss or unplanned weight loss in the previous 3 to 6 months والله لو اقل من 5% بتدي له 0 من 5 ل 10 بتدي له 1% اكتر من 10% بتدي له 2 score او score 2. step 3 acute disease effect score if the patient is acutely ill and there has been or is likely to be non-nutritional intake for more than 5 days بتدي له score 2 وفي step 4 انت بتجمع السكور دي كلها والله لو خد 0 يبقى ده low risk خد 1 medium risk 2 or more ده high risk. also short nutritional assessment questionnaire ده questionnaire فيه اسئله معينه بتتسال وبناء عليها انت بتدي سكورز وفي الاخر برضه زي ما قلنا بنجمع السكورز وبتحدد هل هو mild ولا moderate ولا severe يعني بس مثلا do you lose weight unintentionally more than 6 kilogram that 3 in the last 6 months more than 3 kilogram in the last month ده بياخد 2 did you experience a decreased appetite over the last month لو yes بياخد score 1 did you supplemental drinks or few feeding over the last month لو yes ده بياخد score 1 وبتجمعها بقى لو خد 1 ده نوع انترفينشن خد 2 ده مودريت مان نارجد، لو خد 3 ده بيبقى سيفيرلي مان نارجد. ففي اكوردنج تو ذا ناشونال انستيتيوت اوف هيلث اند كير اكسلنس برضه في سكرينينج تول، هل هو لو هو ماينور ريسك فاكتور، ميجر ريسك فاكتور، فيري هاي ريسك فاكتور. الماينور ريسك فاكتور لو هو لو البي ام اي اقل من 18.5، لو في ان بلاند ويت لوس اكتر من 10% ان ذا بريفيوس 3 او 6 مانث، فيري ليتل او نو نوتريشنال انتيك فور مور ذان 5 دايز، هيستوري اوف الكول اور دراج ابيوز. الميجر ريسك فاكتور لو اقل كانت اقل من 18.5 دلوقتي بقت اقل من 16 بادي ماس اندكس، الان انتشنال ويت لوس اكتر من 15%، في المايد كان 10%، نيوتريشن فيري ليتل نيوتريشن انتيك فور مور ذان 10 دايز، هناك كان مور ذان 5 دايز، اند ليفل اوف سيرم بوتاسيوم فوسفورس اند ماجنيزيوم. الفير هاي ريسك بي ام اي ليس ذان 14 ويت لوس اكتر من 20% وستارفيشن اكتر من 15 دايز. طيب لما نجمع ده بقى وتديله سكورنج امتى يبقى ماين ريسك، لو خد لو عنده واحد ريسك فاكتور من جروب ايه اللي هو ماين ريسك فاكتور، اما بالهاي ريسك لو خد 2 ريسك فاكتور في جروب ايه، او لو عنده 2 ماينور، يعني لو عنده 2 ماينور ريسك فاكتور او 1 ميجر ريسك فاكتور ده بيبقى هاي ريسك. فير هاي ريسك لو عنده 1 اوف ذا فيري هاي ريسك فاكتور اللي هو بي ام اي اقل من 14 او البي او ويت لوس اكتر من 20% او الستارفيشن اكتر من 15 دايز. طيب بيشنت ات ريسك، طبعا انا هعمل هايلايتنج لبعض البيشنت. طبعا بيشنت انوركسيا نيرفوزا از ات هاي ريسك اوف ريفيدنج سيندروم، كرونيك الكوهوليز الكول اوفن ريبليس اذر نيوتريانت resulting in insufficient intake of this nutrient, which is primary malnutrition, but because under certain conditions, the calories provided by alcohol can't be used effectively by the body, which is called the empty calories. And the body is not getting any benefits from this calories provided by alcohol. So it leads to malnutrition and the Refeeding syndrome. Also, the oncology patient. Several factors contribute to weight loss among patients with cancer. طبعا بتعتمد على التيومر لوكيشن، هل هو هيدا النك ولا لا، في السيرجري طبعا العينين بيشنت او العينين الانكولوجي انكولوجي ان بيشنت بيبقى عندهم بيبقوا في ان ستيت اوف هايبر كاتابوليزم. طبعا وبرده زي ما قلنا اللوكيشن اوف ذا تيومر، سيرجري، كيموثيرابي، راديوثيرابي، ستريس، وايفن ذا تريتمنت سايد افكت ويتش انكلود نوزيا، فوميتنج، دايريا، انوركسيا، ماوث سور، difficulty swallowing, taste changes, and poor appetite. Post-operative patients, cystic fibrosis, inflammatory bowel disease, elderly uncontrolled diabetes, mellitus. طبعا احنا قلنا metabolic changes of Refeeding syndrome are related to hypophosphatemia, hypokalemia, hypomagnesemia, sodium retention and hyperglycemia, which take place in Refeeding syndrome. And those are believed to be mainly related to increased insulin secretion following the high carbohydrate intake. طبعا احنا عارفين العين الكنترول دايبيتس هايبر جلايسيميك، طبعا ده بيستميت انسولين سيكريشن ويبدا تحصل المشاكل بقى اللي هو شيفت في الانترسير شيفت اوف فوسفورس ماجنيزيوم اند بوتاسيوم ويش ليد تو ديبيلز ان سيرام ليفل. طبعا افلكس اوف صوديوم فروم سيل اند ديبيلز اكسكريشن اوف صوديوم اند ووتر انتو سولت اند ووتر ريتينشن اند كونجستيف هارت فيلير. وطبعا دي مين بس في يعني بس في سيرجيا في الفينيكس سيندروم. Also chronic malnutrition زي as melasmas, prolonged fasting, و low energy diet. Morbid obesity with weight loss. Due to clinic weight loss after surgery, obese patients are at risk for evolving Refeeding syndrome when receiving increased food intake after achieving sufficient weight loss. This applies especially to patients with post-operative complications. Also, long-term antacid user, which will lead to hypophosphatemia, which we mentioned before, it is the hallmark of Refeeding syndrome. Only hypophosphatemia can define a patient as having Refeeding syndrome. And also long-term diuretics. What about treatment of Refeeding syndrome? Let's talk about fluid hydration deficiencies and abnormal losses like fever, vomiting, and diarrhea should be addressed at the start of replenishment phase. طبعا الـ losses دي المفروض هي بتتزود على الـ fluids calculation. The balanced solution should be the preferred option except when replacing gastric or fistula losses over stoma. طبعا fistula losses there is extensive losses and also especially loss of protein and electrolyte disturbance and associated with malnutrition and dehydration and sepsis. And also enteral nutrition is has a priority in its treatment to protect the gut barrier and to prevent bacterial translocation. The fluid prescription should include the daily maintenance requirement plus the water and electrolyte replacement of any losses. زي ما احنا قلنا في اول سطر طبعا المينتنس should be calculated in addition to water and electrolyte replacement of any losses. طب in general fluid intake of 25 to 35 ملل per kg per day is sufficient to maintain an adequate hydration state. The fluid intake through artificial nutrition, infusion and intravenous administration drugs mainly antibiotics should be taken into account as well as the salt content. طبعا احنا قلنا في البصر السيولوجي ان في فوليوم اوفر لود وفي ديكريز اوف صوديوم اكسكريشن فروم ذا كيدني فده فعشان كده السولت كونتنت شود بي كونسيدر. الفلويد بالانس شود بي كوركتلي كوشسلي اند تشيك ديلي ديوريتكس سبيشالي كومبيتيتيف الدوستيرون انتاجونس ريجليتنج صوديوم ترانسبورت ان ذا كيدني مي بي يوسفول ان كيس اوف فلويد اكسس. طبعا احنا عارفين برضه في الباسيف سيولوجي ان في ريتينشن اوف صوديوم اند ووتر وفي هايبوكاليميا تو تو انتراسيلر شيفت اوف بوتاسيوم. الدايوريتكس ديت بتانتاجونايز ادوستيرون اكشن ان مينرال كورتيكويد ريسبتور اند انتاجونايز اور ذا ادوستيرون انديوز بوتاسيوم اكسكريشن اند ريابسوربشن اوف صوديوم. عشان ما يبقاش فيه مور فوليوم اوفرلود والهايبوكاليميا زي ما احنا قلنا ليها كومبليكيشن كتير جدا عشان ما تزيدش او ما يبقاش فيه مور كومبليكيشن فروم هايبوكاليميا. Particular attention should be paid to the sodium concentration of fluid product given to patients at high risk and very high risk for refeeding syndrome. Sodium restriction less than 1 millimole per kg per day should be considered in the first days after the start of nutritional therapy in order to avoid fluid overload. What about macronutrients? Starting energy intake at lower rate than the generally used in order to prevent refeeding syndrome in patients at high risk. Energy supply should be initiated at lower levels, starting with initial amount of 5 to 15 kcal per kg per day, and increase stepwise depending on the lab parameters and the clinical situation of the patient. The full energy requirement should be met within 5 to 10 days, depending on the prior risk of stratification, using a common nutritional macronutrient composition of 46% carbohydrate, 34% fat, and 15 to 20% protein. طبعا ده سلايد المشهور جدا بتاع المال نيوتريشن. طبعا في الاول بيبقى في شيك اوف مال نيوتريشن عن طريق السكريننج تول زي ما احنا قلنا الماسكول or NRS 2002 in hospitalized patients. بعد كده في optimization of nutrition status by diet counseling for an expert nutritionist and dietitian. بعد كده في supplementation of vitamins and minerals when indicated and regular exercise with precautions. Also if the patient does didn't meet his requirement from oral intake, we shift to oral nutrition supplement. And if he didn't meet his nutrition needs, we can shift to enteral nutrition. And also, if he didn't get his nutrition needs, or there is there is indication for we shift it into enteral nutrition, especially if there is contraindication to enteral nutrition. What about admitted patients in ICU? We have two options. Is he intubated or not intubated? If he is not intubated, we will assume, as we said before, we start by oral diet, their oral nutrition supplement, then internal nutrition. If there are limitations for the internal route, it could be advised to prescribe referral for internal nutrition in the population of reaching energy, protein target, by oral or enteral nutrition type. If intubated, if the patient is admitted to ICU and is intubated, enteral nutrition should be started through a nasogastric tube. Both hydraulic feeding should be performed in patients with gastric intolerance after bronchiectasis treatment or patient at high risk for aspiration. In ICU, patient who doesn't tolerate full dose enteral nutrition during the first week in ICU. Initiating parenteral nutrition should be weighed on a case by case basis. But if he is admitted to ICU and with dysphagia, then we texture adapted food can be considered after extubation. If swallowing is proven unsafe, enteral nutrition should be administered. Right, what about micronutrients? Patients with refeeding syndrome have depleted intracerebral micronutrient stores, which may cause a drop in the serum level. Therefore, it is essential to correct electrolyte before initiation of the nutritional support, with supplementation of phosphate and thiamine being particularly important, especially phosphate and thiamine. And also, as I mentioned before, hypophosphatemia is the hallmark of refeeding syndrome. Prophylactic phosphate supplement should be undertaken at patients with high risk for refeeding syndrome, even in case of normal serum, to avoid occurrence of refeeding syndrome. As we said before, hypophosphatemia played a key role in refeeding syndrome. During the starvation, body stores of phosphate decrease despite normal serum level. As long as energy metabolism depends on fat oxidation, phosphate is not required. But as soon as the patient resumes carbohydrate intake, the metabolism of glucose uses large amounts of phosphate, thus leading to a drop in its serum level. The prophylactic supplementation of high dose of thiamine to 100 to 300 milligrams at least 30 minutes before beginning refeeding is fundamental. Vitamins used supplemented to 100% of recommended daily intake. First element should be supplemented to 100%. Electrolytes, especially phosphate, potassium, magnesium, must be closely monitored and supplemented throughout the refeeding period. As I mentioned before, hypokalemia is worsened by concomitant hypomagnesemia, since magnesium is essential for the sodium potassium pump activity and therefore an important factor in the tubular absorption of potassium. Potassium supplementation alone is insufficient, and the persistent low potassium value despite supplementation can be corrected by simultaneous magnesium substitution. It shows the importance of magnesium in potassium metabolism. Hypocalcemia may cause or worsen hypophosphatemia. What about iron? Iron shouldn't be supplemented in the first week after the start of nutrition support, even in case of manifest iron deficiency, as blood production requires a high amount of potassium. Parenteral iron supplementation must be considered with caution in managed catabolic patients, as it may induce or prolong hypophosphatemia. What about the monitoring? Refeeding syndrome generally occurs within the first 3 days after initiation of nutrition support and may progress very rapidly. In the vulnerable phase, initiative or intensive clinical monitoring of vital signs and hydration, as well as analysis of lab parameters, is very important to detect the early signs of refeeding syndrome, such as fluid overload and organ failure, especially kidney. Body weight and hydration should be checked on a daily basis. As an increase of 0.3 to 0.5 kilograms per day is an initial sign of pathological fluid retention. This diagram shows scheduling of monitoring. As we said before, we should monitor body weight, fluid balance, vital signs, clinical manifestation, hydration state, edema, pulmonary status, lab parameters, phosphorus, potassium, magnesium, sodium, calcium, glucose, urea, and creatinine. In the first 3 days, we should monitor daily. In the next 3 days, monitor every second day. And from day 7 to day 10, monitor 1 to 2 times per week. What about ECG? As we said before, the main cause of death, or common cause of death from Refeeding syndrome, is cardiac arrhythmia. So it is recommended only during the first 3 days in patients who are at high risk of refeeding, or it is already affected by severe electrolyte imbalance prior to refeeding. As you may have severe arrhythmia, Q-tube prolongation up to start the point. Electrolyte substitution in case of extracellular electrolyte level dropping. In case of edema, tachycardia, tachypnea, symptoms should be treated individually, and nutritional therapy should be continued according to the algorithm of high risk category. يعني لو حصل complication هي edema أو tachycardia أو tachypnea بتعالجها وفي نفس الوقت تستمر في النيوتريشنال سبورت اكوردنج تو ذا الجوريزم اوف هاي ريسك كاتيجوري. طيب ذيس تيبل شوز ويت اوف سبلمنتيشن اوف دوز اوف سبلمنتيشن اوف بوتاسيوم مغنيسيوم اند فوسفيت in different stages of Refeeding syndrome, in mild deficiency, moderate deficiency, severe deficiency. At the end, we should remember that Refeeding syndrome is the hidden enemy of critically ill child and if underestimated, it is fatal. And also, as we said before, Refeeding syndrome, Refeeding syndrome and the metabolic syndrome are two sides of the same coin. We noticed in each complication, hypertriglyceridemia, hypophosphatemia, hypomagnesemia, hypokalemia, which affect metabolism of glucose and also associated with insulin resistance and also fatty liver, which is considered a criteria of metabolic syndrome. Two sides of the same coin means that they are different, but they look different, but they are related to each other. So, due to its complication and its relation to carbohydrate and lipid metabolism, many papers or researches mention that Refeeding syndrome and metabolic syndrome are two sides of the same coin. You can't cross the sea merely by standing and staring at water. You should suspect, you should screen for risk for patients at high risk, and then you should stratify them according to its to the screening. Is he mild? Is he mild malnutrition? Moderate risk, severe risk, and then you should treat and supply and monitor the as we said before, vital signs, electrolyte disturbance, fluid balance. In order to, and also as we said before, teamwork between the nutrition team, between the physician, nurse, pharmacist, and dietitian is important for the proper outcome of the patient. And thank you so much, and I hope you like and it is fruitful for you. I hope that you understand, and I am ready for any question for the lecture. And thank you so much.